been called California poet, a New York poet, a Texas poet, a Southern poet, a Black or African American poet, a woman poet, a feminist poet, an academic poet, an experimental poet. I've been called a spoken word poet, which I definitely am not, and or a performance poet, you know, so I don't know about all of that. I've been in California for a pretty long time. I went to graduate school. California, for me, has a lot to do with just surviving as a poet, because I think I probably was already going to be a teacher. My mother was a teacher, my grandmother was a teacher, and if you go back another generation, they were just barely out of slavery, and they were the first generation to become literate. So the written word means a lot to me, literacy means a lot to me, teaching is important to me, and I think I probably wouldn't have become a poet, although I was writing poetry, I wouldn't have been calling myself a poet if it hadn't been for my experience in universities. So I think I became a poet as an undergraduate at the University of Texas in Austin, and coming here has allowed me to continue to think of myself as a poet at the same time that I'm teaching literature courses. So, you know, when people call me an academic poet, I suppose that's kind of accurate, because the academy has meant that I can actually survive as a poet. So I want to talk a little bit about my most recent book, which is Urban Tumbleweed. And this is probably the most sort of place-based book that I have done. When I look back on it, Sleeping with the Dictionary, which was published while I was here, a lot of it was written while I was here. It is, in certain ways, a very Los Angeles and California-centric book. It thinks about Los Angeles as kind of the center between the United States and, you know, the whole Pacific Rim. It thinks about California in that way. I mean, that's one of the things it's trying to do. But this book, Urban Tumbleweed, was really partly, in some ways, a response to my students here at UCLA, because I can recall some students saying they hate nature poetry because they live in the city and they don't relate to nature. And I thought, in Los Angeles, all cities, you know, where we really actually have quite a bit of interaction with what could be called a natural world. And right here on this campus, we have a botanical garden, you know, where I was sort of slowly learning the names of things, but, you know, they don't quite stick in my brain, so I keep going back and visiting those trees and reading the labels on them. And I do take my students there in creative writing. I try to do that at least once in the quarter. At the beginning, we go to the botanical garden and we write tonka, which I think is very suitable for that kind of exercise. So that's kind of was the one of the original motivations for this book. And the other one is that I write slowly, and I have long periods between books. And even though I'm writing all the time, I'm mostly writing anything but poetry. And so this particular project was to at least salvage a portion of my day for poetry. And so that's actually how this book got written. The project was to write a tonka a day. And tonka is only 31 syllables, so I thought that might be possible. So, okay, so I'm going to just say, have a little very basic thing to say about the whole process of writing tonka, and it's very basic, so excuse me for that. So Urban Tumbleweed is my adaptation of tonka, a form of Japanese poetry, and part of a tradition that is more than 1,000 years old. I had never before worked with either tonka or haiku, so I came to this tradition as a rather naive learner. And I'm sure there are people here who know much more about this tradition than I do, but I'm going to share a few things that I learned in finding my own way to connect with the tradition of writing tonka, with the understanding that this is basic knowledge. So like many American poets, I was introduced first to haiku, which I found somewhat more familiar and available in translation than tonka. And I was introduced to tonka through an anthology of mostly haiku, which is titled Japanese Death Poems, written by Zen monks and haiku poets on the verge of death. Man, that's a cheerful It is compiled with an introduction by Joel Hoffman. And I had this book around my house for years before I ever thought of writing talk. I just, something about that title just appealed to me. And I would often go to that book and just read a few, you know, just to think about that. And Hoffman's introduction describes the earliest Japanese poetry as, quote, simple in structure and free of formal constraints. These verses celebrate the beauty of nature, love and longing, and loyalty to the sovereign in what seem like bursts of spontaneous expression. That's his quotation. And the earliest anthology of Japanese poetry contains more than 4,000 poems. According to Hoffman, he says, it seems to have been compiled by court officials, back to the court again, and yet along with verses composed by emperors and noblemen, there is the work of monks, of warriors, and even of common people. Imagine that. It seems that the writing of poetry was not the pastime of an exclusive few with special talent, nor was it confined to any particular class. And other accounts I have read suggest that poetry played an important role in creating a unified Japanese culture with a set of aesthetic values defining the national character. And much of what attracted me to tanka is enumerated in Hoffman's description of early Japanese poetry, its apparent simplicity and spontaneity, its relative freedom of form, and its traditional inclusiveness, such that in ancient times and again in modern times, the practice of writing and reading haiku and tanka have been available to any literary person in Japan, although Hoffman and others also mention periods in Japanese literary history when poetry became a more esoteric practice, monopolized by court poets who could advance their careers through literary accomplishment. So dating back at least as early as AD 712, with the first poetry anthology appearing at the end of the 8th century, early Japanese poetry was mainly two forms, a long poem called the choka and a short poem, tanka. Both forms, tanka and choka, are constituted around alternating lines of 5 or 7 syllables, and this traditional pattern identifies these forms as poetry in the Japanese language, which is based on a syllabary rather than an alphabet. And a syllabary is a phonetic writing system consisting of symbols representing syllables. So a syllable often is made up of a consonant plus a vowel or a single vowel. And so the syllabic type of poetry is very intrinsic to the way the language is formed. So it's unlike English in that respect. Haiku is derived from tanka, which is the older of the two. Haiku emerged from the collaborative practice of poets writing renga, with one poet writing the opening or upper verse, first 3 units of 5-7-5, another poet completing the tanka with the closing or lower verse, the concluding 2 units of 7-7. Eventually, haiku emerges its own freestanding, self-sufficient form. Japanese poets typically write both tanka and haiku as a single line, which when translated into English is conventionally rendered as 3-line, 17-syllable haiku, or 5-line, 31-syllable tanka, where the line breaks indicate poetic units of 5 or 7 syllables in the poem's original language. So my limited knowledge of the form is based on reading translations of a few classical and modern Japanese poets, along with contemporary tanka composed in English. While embracing the notational spirit of the tradition, I depart from established conventions in both languages, choosing instead a flexible 3-line form with a variable number of syllables per line. Some people says, well, that means it's not even tanka. Okay, fine, whatever. But I try to adhere to the 31-syllable unit, although I am aware that the number of syllables in any given word can vary, especially in English. So depending on the speaker, the circumstances, California sometimes has 4 syllables, other times 5. Or what about bilingual, 3 syllables or 4? So for reasons that I understand only partially, tanka attracted me more than haiku. Both are extremely brief, but I wanted those 2 extra lines that tanka allowed. Haiku frequently is described as a snapshot of nature without explicitly noting the presence of a human observer. Tanka, on the other hand, typically includes both a natural phenomenon and a human response to what is perceived in nature making the topic a complex interaction of the human being with the natural context. It's this more complicated, I suppose, and aestheticized relationship to nature and culture that attracted me to the tanka. A practice of daily writing, compiling a kind of diary, also is a traditional use of Japanese forms, such as tanka, haiku, and haibun. Haibun is a combination of prose passages, such as entries in a journal or travelogue, with accompanying haiku verses. So my intention was to keep a kind of diary. I wanted to write tanka a day for a year. I actually did it for more than a year, and then I condensed it to 366, which represents a year and a day of writing tanka. It's a leap year of tanka. And I wanted to read maybe a few of mine, but also just wanted to start reading some translations from a collection that's in our library on campus. It's called Owaka Anthology. Since I don't know how to read Japanese, I have no idea judging the accuracy or the worthiness of this translation. But the volume is edited by Edwin A. Cranston. It's called Owaka Anthology. Owaka is the general term for Japanese poetry. It includes all those forms that I mentioned. So here are a few of these, some of my favorites. In the sunlit grasses, growing here beside my house, lurks every shadow where the chirping crickets cry, and I listen but do not weary. Under the fuzzy peach in the doorway of my house, the moon is shining. How good I feel within my heart. Lately things have been so strange. My little house, my little cottage is under Miwa Mountain, and if you miss me, pray you come and find me there. The cedar stands by the gate. You know, one of the things that I love about these three was the prepositions. You know, like there are shadows under each blade of grass, and under those blades of grass, crickets are hiding and chirping. You know, and that the moon is below the peach. You know, under the fuzzy peach in the doorway of my house, the moon is shining. I love that. So those are some of the things that really attracted me to the form. And also that I think after, you know, however many hundreds or thousands of years, that voice of that human being is, just seems so clear, so lucid, you know, that I can immediately connect myself to that. And I thought that was something that I might have been losing in the poetry that I was writing. One of my editors wrote to me and said, this may be your more accessible book, and I don't like to use that word, because of course accessible is a bad word. But I thought, why is it such a bad word? Because, if people can read what you write and they can understand it, why is that bad? And also, I have spent a lot of time explaining my work to people, even other scholars and poets. You know, so I think there's a whole book of me explaining my poetry to a friend, you know, who's a scholar and a poet. So so I thought this will be a little something different. So I'll just read a few, I guess, from Urban Tumbleweed. The morning news landed in the driveway, folded, rolled, and rubber banded, wrapped in plastic for protection from the morning dews. By midday, the ardent sun burns through the chilly morning fog and cloudy haze that weather reporters call May gray and June gloom. Instead of scanning newspaper headlines, I spend the morning reading names of flowers and trees in the botanical garden. Chain link fence, locked gate, protect this urban garden. Fugitive fragrance of honeysuckle escapes to tempt the passing stranger. Purple jacaranda blooms spectacular on branches overhead, underfoot a sticky mess where they land on the sidewalk. Awakened too early on Saturday morning by the song of a mockingbird imitating my clock radio alarm. Why should I care about my neighbor's riotous dandelions? Does he concern himself with my slovenly jacaranda? Shady eucalyptus grove where sleeping butterflies cover each limb of every tree, a rest stop on their migratory flight. Even in this landscaped paradise, people buy fresh cut flowers, considered more aesthetic than the ones growing in the yard. We plan to hike to the top of the trail for a breathtaking view of Pacific, but turn back down at the sight of a rattler. I can't help feeling at war with the elements under this fierce onslaught of rain, with just as sad umbrella as sword and shield. Remember rain?
It's good rain.
Not falling into infinite night of stars, but marks of a black pencil, sketching dimensions, depths, and shades of moody darkness. Neglected, lapsed in memory, declined, dilapidated, fallen into decay, crumbled into dust,